There we go. Hi, good afternoon. It's Jason Leach, live from Diglis, in the rain. We're just going to give it a quick couple of minutes to see if we can get a few people join us online. The weather report, I think, was really accurate today. It said it'll start raining just about 1 o'clock, and, well, lo and behold, it has. We're going to try and do our best to bring you this live event. Despite the rain and my notes being wet, and there being a bit of water in the bottom of the fish pass. We're going to give it a go anyway. We said we would. We're going to bring the fish pass to you in the comfort of your own home or office or where you happen to be. We're getting wet, so you don't have to. Okay, we've got a few people joining. Hi, everybody. I think we'll kind of make a start, just in case the rain gets heavier. So I'm here, I'm Jason Leach, Programme Director for Unlocking the Severn. I work for Canal and River Trust. I've got Steph Wheeler, who's just in the background, our events officer, just around to help me out, point me in the right direction, and film me if I fall over. We have risk assessed it, but there's still quite a few hazards walking around with this. Well, the first thing is just to talk about why we're here. Today's World Fish Migration Day. It's a celebration of migratory fish and the aim to raise awareness of their plight, particularly when rivers aren't free flowing and there are blockages to their migration. International Day, lots of events worldwide. We've already participated in a webinar this morning with Denmark, and I think there was France and a few other countries there, which was great to be part of. And why are we here? What's the project Unlocking the River Severn? Well, this is a huge project aimed at unlocking the River Severn for people and wildlife. The wildlife particularly being the twaite shad, which is an amazing fish. It's one of the UK's rarest fish. And the reason for that is because our predecessors, about 170 years ago, built locks and weirs. And I'm just going to try and toggle around so I can show you the landscape. So this is the River Severn. This is the largest, longest river in the UK. And about 170 years ago, we built a series of locks and weirs. Now we did that because boats, just during that early years of the Industrial Revolution, struggled to get into Birmingham and out of Birmingham, plying their goods and trade because of low flows. So what the authorities did back then was to effectively turn the river into a navigation, creating long pools of deep water so the Severn Trows and other ships and boats could get up to Stourport, transship their goods onto narrow boats, that will then head into the Black Country, Birmingham, to fuel that Industrial Revolution. Prior to that point, though, salmon and shad on the River Severn were a key commodity for local communities. They were sold far and wide, even to the courts of kings. Now, I'm just thinking at the moment, the screen at the needs a bit of a... Just pause. I think the screen's all really wet. Ah, here we go. I think we're back. So the fish, the shad and the salmon were incredibly important to local communities. And when these weirs were built, pretty much overnight in the next few years, migratory fish populations crashed. Salmon carried on because their ability to jump, whereas shad, despite being strong swimmers, they're just not able to jump. So overnight, the furthest upstream they could get was Worcester. And since that day, the shad has clung onto its small section of its former range, downstream of Worcester. And part of the project's been done by the Environment Agency and Bournemouth and Hull Universities has been to actually monitor these populations and try and work out how big they are. And we estimate that there's probably 10 to 15,000 of these fish that are associated with the River Severn, which is a tiny fragment of what they used to be back in the day. So the project is primarily aimed at removing these blockages by creating these four large fish passes on the River Severn and remove two weirs on the River Teme to allow the shad to get back to their original spawning grounds. And we're confident over the coming years and decades, it will really help rebuild their population. So just a little bit about the project. As I've mentioned, we're building four, the Canal and River Trust as lead partner, we're building four large fish passes. This is Diglis near Worcester. This is the largest of them. And I'll come on to a little bit more detail about this fish pass. We'll have a walk through it in a short time. The Environment Agency have already undertaken the partial removal of two weirs on the River Teme, which is a tributary of the Severn. I've mentioned the scientific research of shad populations, but we've also got a huge community engagement outreach program, which involves education, school visits, and a schools program. We have volunteering, both for citizen science and counting fish, both on the river and at home via our website, and direct conservation volunteering on and around the river. We have a wide range of interpretation features that we've been installing and plan to install to tell the story of the shad and the project. And prior to COVID, we had a major events program. We've had to change all that to be more flexible and more virtual, hence us being here behind a camera and not in person with a lot of people. And the project was made possible by the Canal and River Trust, Environment Agency, and Severn Rivers Trust, and Natural England, coming together back in 2013, coming up with this amazing idea. We've managed to secure funding from National Lottery Heritage Fund, just over £10 million from them, which is the largest environment grant they've given out, which is amazing, and they provided amazing support. And the EU Life Programme. This is the second biggest grant to the UK and primarily focused on improving the shad populations so we can improve the special area of conservation sites in the Severn Estuary. And we've built a great team. It's easy for me to stand here in the rain chatting about this, but we have a team of engineers, project managers, we've got our construction partners, Kier Construction, we have our community outreach program with Steph, who's here, Jenny and others behind the scenes working tirelessly to get this project going. So it's two parts. So we've got the construction of the big civil engineering project and we've got the community outreach. That's the kind of background, that's where we're kind of up to. From a program perspective, we're hoping to wrap up the engineering works next year, but we're going to extend the activity program beyond that into 2022 to really make sure we get the story of the shad and engage lots of people in the river and the story of the fish. So next, I'm going to try and take you on a tour of the fish pass. Before I do that, I'll just switch back to first person. Diglis Fish Pass, this is our biggest fish pass. It measures 100 metres long, 8 metres wide and about 5 metres deep. And at the height of the construction, we could have parked 32 London buses in here. It was that big. It's a huge, huge undertaking. What you can see from this angle, looking downstream, is the height of the weir. So as I said earlier, the shad can't get up that weir. The height is about 2 metres. The flow is too strong and it's too steep for them to get up. So what we need to do is come up with a solution that lifts them from the lower section of the river to the higher section. And what we've got is a series of pools created by the concrete channel you can see, surrounded by the sheet piling, which at the moment protects us from flooding, but will also provide what we call an augmentation flow, and I'll talk you through that when we get down there. So I'm going to try and safely get myself down into the fish pass, down these clanky steps, into the belly of the fish pass, without falling over. So from this view, I mentioned earlier that we're getting from downstream to upstream in a series of pools, and hopefully you should be able to see the change in height between the pools. Each pool lifts the water and the shad and the fish by about 20 centimetres, which gets us up that 2 metre height barrier the shad have got. And while we're talking about the fish pass and the shad, we feel now that the migratory salmon, lamprey and eels will also benefit from this pass. And coarse fish locally will be able to move up and down. And we're really hopeful that we'll get some resident coarse fish in here. So what I'm going to do is take us down to the bottom of the pass, at which point I'll also just see if I can see any questions. But just bear with me, the screen's hard to see. So I'm just going to get us to the bottom of the pass through these slots. And these are the slots that are named from the deep vertical slot. There are several designs of fish pass that you can use. And our preferred was deep vertical slot because we haven't got a lot of space from a land ownership perspective. And a natural channel, which you will see, it's our stop 6 of the event today. This is stop 5, further upstream at Bevery. So we're actually nearing completion of this one. We're hoping to be commissioning it by Christmas. So here we are at the bottom, the downstream end of the fish pass, and where I'm pointing to now is where the flow from upstream, from behind me, will end up exiting the fish pass. So this will be the first thing the migratory fish and the shad will see. It's fairly narrow, as you can see. It focuses the flow to provide an attraction flow. Migratory fish are attracted to the areas of highest water movement. So we're sure with the orientation of the weir, the fish will edge up the weir into this corner, find this flow, and enter into where I'm stood now. Now if I spin round, you may get a picture of Steph every now and again. Here's the first thing the fish will see. Behind where Steph is stood, you'll just make out a narrow channel. These are the augmentation galleries that will bring the bulk of the flow down the side and outside of each of the pools. And they will come through a trash screen into this area, creating the right sort of flow to attract the fish. I'll just see if I can, at this point, I'll just see if there's any, if I can actually see any of the questions. Mike Morris, Worcester, how do we get involved? I'll come to the involvement at the end. Whereabouts is this? So whereabouts, we're in Diglis at Worcester, part of in Worcestershire on the River Severn. How do we get involved in volunteering? Okay, the easiest thing to do is look at our website, which is unlockingthesevern.co.uk. .co.uk. Hope you're staying dry. Yeah, but kind of, it's eased off a bit now. Okay, if you've got any other questions, just keep them coming. We'll try to answer them live, or we'll pick them up as we go along. Now we're in the guts of the fish pass. The rain does seem to have eased a little bit, which is handy for us. So as I mentioned, this is a deep vertical slot fish pass, and these slots are 500 millimeters wide, half a meter. And when the water comes in, it'll be rushing through these. But as it does rush from pool to pool, the flow is directed into what we call a C-section. And it's effectively a stopper. You see, they just make out the sort of C-section shape. And that stops the flow, and then it backs up and forms eddies, effectively slowing the water down, creating slower moving pools that the fish can wait, get their breath back, and then move to the next one. So how much is the project costing? Overall, the project is about £19 million, which sounds like a heck of a lot of money. But this is something that will last as a legacy for 125 years. That's how long we've designed these structures for. And that's a combination of Heritage Lottery, Heritage Fund, and EU Life, and some contributions from partners. And it is ring-fenced environment improvement funding. So it's hugely beneficial and doesn't take funding away from anywhere else. It is designated as environment funding. So I'm moving up now. There are quite a number of these. We're going to move up the pass, which in total is about 100 metres long. So as I said, we are nearing completion, so a lot of this is looking kind of finished. Where I'm stood now, you can possibly make out these concrete wedges at the bottom of the slot. They will hold cobbles and pebbles that we're going to be putting in the base of this, which adds to the roughness of the bed, will provide a great habitat for invertebrates. Hopefully we'll get some plants in here and young fish will be able to grow and mature. So we're back to where the steps are. It's a great shot actually up. All the slots are in vertical alignment as we go up. So Francis, how deep? Where I'm stood now, it's 5 metres deep. The outer piles take us up to about 6 metres deep. At the height of the construction, we were eight metres down, but obviously we've filled a lot of that with concrete in the base slab. So as I mentioned, the design of the fish pass was developed by some of our consultants, including Fish Tech Consulting, a great outfit there, been really, really supportive and helpful, got us the designs. Colleagues at the Environment Agency have supported that, so we've got the best design to ensure success from a fish passage perspective. And our contractor here have been doing a great job finishing this to such a standard. And we're at the stage now where 95% of the concrete works are now finished. We've got probably another month of that, and then we've got the exciting commissioning, getting the walkways, getting the mechanical and electrical fit out. So here we are, we've got to the top of the fish pass, and there's a big square in front. I'm going to come back and talk about that in a minute. I'm just going to turn right. So at the very top of the fish pass, there's a sharp right turn, and behind those piles is the upstream end of the River Severn. And if I was stood next to there, my head would probably just be bobbing on the sort of water surface. It'd be about 2 metres roughly of water running through here. And these giant columns we've got, and these slots are designed to hold the penstock arrangement. And the penstock will enable us to control the flow into the fish pass, which means we can stop the flow if we need to do any maintenance. So I've reached the top. I think we've covered quite a lot about the augmentation galleries passing the water. We've talked about the C-sections and pools and the inlet and outlet. We've talked about the penstocks. So the last thing to talk about in any detail is our ambition to get this message, get the story of the shad and the environment out to the public and local communities and schools, is the provision of a viewing gallery and a gallery window. So this square leads us to a viewing chamber which will be accessible in May and June particularly, which ties in with the shad migration season. You'll enter it from above, down some galvanised stairs, clanking down into a fitted out chamber, and you will see a 2 metre by 2.4 metre, 2.5 metre window. A window onto the underwater world where we expect the numbers of fish, shad, etc. to swim past. And it's a common question of, well, how do you know they're going to swim past? How will you see them? Surely the water in the River Severn is kind of murky. Well, yes, to all those questions, that it is murky from time to time, but what we've done to give us the best chance is this wide channel will have another structure called our splitter island, which effectively splits the flow into two. We'll have the opportunity through a series of mesh gates to narrow that flow into a half a metre, 500 millimetre channel, which will come this way. And where I'm kind of coming now will be where the fish will swim. And they'll all get corralled, if you like, into a 500 mil wide channel. So there'll be flow across the rest of the width of that, but the fish will be corralled into this. And just to the right of the window, kind of here, will be a backlit panel, LED backlit, which means when you're inside the gallery, looking out through the window, you will be able to see them. Along with public engagement and showing people, you know, this amazing underwater world, we are looking at doing some serious science in here. We'll be having a video camera that will continually video the fish movements, which means we'll be able to count the fish 24 hours a day, effectively, to give us a really accurate estimation of their populations. We'll also have other scientific equipment, some cameras and some receivers in the fish pass to aid with that, which will really help us improve our understanding of shad and other migratory fish ecology. So I think let's just have another check to see if there's any other questions kind of coming up. I think we're, how much is the project? I mentioned that one. Okay, I think we're okay with the questions. So we're kind of coming to the end of the virtual tour of the fish pass. I'm just going to turn the camera so it looks downstream. You can see the where the splitter ion will be in the middle and down the two things. I'll just flick it back onto me briefly. Now, I did have a little prop, but it's a little soggy now, so I can't really show you, of people looking out into the river from the viewing gallery. So just to kind of conclude, you know, thanks for joining us today as part of this World Fish Migration Day celebration. You know, please, please, please do have a look on our website at unlockingthesevern.co.uk. Follow us on Twitter on the handle SevernUnlocked. And it is a really important day today. We've got a campaign, if you like, hashtag Step Up For Fish. You know, please tweet any fishy type stories, any photographs or anything from out and about, or any links or anything onto that hashtag to help us raise the profile of migratory fish and really try and see if we can spread the word. Now, we've just literally just finished. Tech failure right at the end. We have just finished doing a virtual open day on our website, which after this transmission will be live. We're going to post a link to it in the comments below. It'll be on our Twitter feed as well. And you can look on canalandrivertrust.org.uk. And in conclusion, this is really what all the partners are about. Canal and River Trust, we manage the nation's canals for people and waterways. This is all about well-being. We're really keen to engage more people in rivers, canals and the outdoor environment, and hopefully get greater engagement, people coming out and seeing what we do. So again, just check us out on unlockingthesevern.co.uk, at Severn Unlocked, and our main webpage at canalrivertrust.org.uk. Thanks for joining us.